Even though there's no football game, 7:30 is still our deadline, so we're going to be out here 7:30. Plan on that. That's the deal.
Oh, well.
I'm sure we can appreciate that because I think we have a little bit of breath to catch after a long day. So again, thank you for being here. Most of our group worked today and work will be as a group in small groups, and then some large group reporting out. We're going to be focusing on the agenda that was sent out.
I can't see that far.
And so again, I appreciate everybody being here. Bob is going to really take this away, except a couple of housekeeping items. We did not actually send you minutes because we have to do that by actually protocol and law. So Cheryl will be putting together the minutes for last meeting and this meeting for our next meeting, and then we will approve those at that time. Just kind of a housekeeping piece so that we kind of keep track of what we're doing when we're doing it. We'll certainly have more documentation than that, but I just wanted to alert you that we omitted that section on the agenda. And even though this seems somewhat informal, it's technically still a public meeting, so we want to handle it appropriately. So that was one oversight that we had. With that, Bob, you just want to take a quick message from the board? It'd be great. And then we'll move on to the next Bob.
First of all, thank you for giving up an evening to come here and talk about these interesting things we have right now. Compensation is a very important item. Everybody wants to know how they're being paid. We're looking at changes. Changes make people nervous, especially when it affects your paycheck. So the fact you guys are willing to give your time to help the board make a good decision, I can't say thank you enough. So we need your guidance. We need your help as we move forward to make sure that the decisions we come to are good decisions for everybody. So thank you for that, and appreciate your work.
One last piece. Because of the conflict that we want to make sure Bob's available, we'd like to actually shift one meeting that was scheduled for March 4th from 5:30 to 7:30 to March 3rd from 5:30 to 7:30. So if we can move that up one day, if you could at least take a look at that either tonight, we can check in with everybody at the end of the meeting to make sure that if that becomes problematic for like everybody, it's like, oh my God, I can't, you know, we got a bunch of people that can't come. We can kind of figure that out, but hopefully there's enough time in advance to sort of make that shift one day earlier, same time, same place. So take a look at the calendars. We'll kind of check back in with you at the end of the meeting.
Thanks, Todd. So you might have noticed when you came in, we weren't all sitting at one big table looking at it, and that was obviously done purposefully. It's one of the things that we've attempted in other districts, and I believe it has worked well, is when we've gotten to certain issues, we've broken out into some subgroups, and the subgroups are trying to be broken up into particular pairings in order to get some differences of opinions at one table. And so what we're going to look at doing tonight is two goals, the first of which I definitely would want us to accomplish, and that is coming to an agreement on what we want the survey document to look like that'll get sent out to all the staff. Because one of the key elements of this process is getting input from a broad cross-section of employees, and so your role in that is to sit there and look at what I have as an example of a survey and look at it from the perspective of, A, do I think this is understandable? B, are there amendments I'd like to make to this, either additions, deletions, or a completely new way of asking a question? That's fine as well, because we don't want a misinterpretation of what the answers are. And this data is valuable for us because it both has quantitative, people are going to rank particular things and have numbers, but it will also have qualitative data where people can give us text answers as to what it is that they view as to be a strength in the present system, a weakness, what they view would be a strength in a new system or a weakness, et cetera. And we can get those ideas together. We can then run it through the SurveyMonkey and see, are a lot of terms coming up frequently in this? Are there things that are outliers? But it gives us a grounding for how we proceed on it. So what I would like to do with that is first just show you the survey real quick, the draft. We have to take pride in authorship in this. This has been used in several districts, but it's been tweaked around the particular districts. And how it starts off, it's just a simple SurveyMonkey, and we do want to keep it somewhere in the 10 to 15 minute range. I'm not a statistician, although I like to play one at times, I guess. But we have, as an organization, used various statisticians from the UW-Madison. And one of the things they tell us when we survey our members is A, the timeline for, or the time impact of completing a survey. You know, if you go beyond 10 minutes or so, you're going to start having people drop off and not fill it out. The second piece is we don't have to get 100% response rate. In a typical survey, once they get 25 to 35%, that is going to be consistent with people thereafter. Now, when we've done this in school districts, we've gotten 70 to 80%. That's my hope, that we would give people enough lead time, we'd make the survey understandable, then we'd report the results back to them. So they saw that data as well, and they realized that the committee has this information for going forward. So I'm trying to blow this up a little bit here. The first element of it is to look at it from the standpoint of trying to get some demographic data. So these are the breakdowns we have now. We can do it more narrow, or we can drill down even further to have the particular elementary school or the middle school, although I don't know if that's really relevant. Okay, so we're just trying to get an idea of where the demographics are. When we do the survey, we are not getting it from the standpoint we're going to get the individual IP address and go, oh, I know how Cheryl answered the question. So that's not our point on that. So that won't be something that I will collect and then have that available in the report, right? Because I don't want to get that kind of thing. It put a chilling effect on people's responses. So the beginning of the survey just asks demographic information from the individual. The next piece that we would be looking at then is years of service. And again, this can we can use to cross-reference to see if more experienced staff have a different response on a particular question to those who are more new to the district. So we can get an idea as to how the pay system or these questions are impacted by where people are. And it gives us overall answering based on bands of years of service in the district. Then this is an open-ended text question of just what were the top one to three strengths of the last negotiated professional educator compensation system. So our salary grid, what were the strengths of that system? And people delineate what they liked about it. And there may be something we glean from that. If people might say, what we've seen a lot of answers, it showed me a pathway for my career as to how I could go and ascend up to a higher salary. I could kind of guess what my lifetime earnings were. Lifetime earning potential is an important piece too. So that might be something that's delineated as a strength, but there could be anything else that could be put in there too, whether it ties to professional development, education, rank, recognizing length of service, etc. So pretty open-ended, but this is a text question. Then similarly, we ask the converse of it, top one to three weaknesses. It's fine if someone puts in nothing. They didn't think there was a weakness, they could put in three. And oh, again, we would get all that data through qualitative answer on this. It's not a fill in these particular circles. And then we could look at that again to see if we see trends amongst the answers. The next question here is we're ranking the following factors based on their importance in our compensation system. So this will obviously vary depending upon the employee's tenure in the school district and what particular background they might have. So if I have an advanced degree, a master's degree, I might view that as being more important than someone who didn't. But it's trying to get an overall ranking of that, and it's a weighted average. So when the survey results come back, the numbers that are highest, so if I rated something number one, it's actually, the way the formula is set up, the highest ranked item won't have a number of like one, it would actually have the highest cumulative score, because it meant the most people weighted that as the most important thing. So the higher number up to a maximum of however other items we have in here that we decide upon, would be the item. And then we could see the relative stacking as to what people felt were important things to be in a new compensation system. And this is not all inclusive that I have here. You might think something's been omitted, or you might think this list is too long or it's duplicative. That's what the hope is for this group to talk about. And you see here's an example of how they break out underneath that. Then we also have a question of, you know, what do you hope for given the changes in public education, et cetera? What are the top one to three opportunities you believe could be built in to improve upon the last negotiated compensation system? So once again, another qualitative question that goes out there for people and open-end provide their inputs to what they'd like to see. And then same thing, what do you think the challenges are to consider in changing from the last item? So a lot of questions come up on this on how people are going to be transferred onto the new system.
what's going to happen to their pay, et cetera. The board has already addressed that particular element. And as a group, you might think of adding some qualifier to the survey that says, what are the challenges? Please be aware that the board has already stated, bing, 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 bing. Because that might be a change we put in to this particular survey. And then the level of agreement about the following. So these ask questions about where people, what their satisfaction is, so to speak, with present pay, present benefits. Do I view my pay as competitive or not? And we see this at the front end of the process. Then as we go through it, we get data. Unless we see how we line up on particular elements. So those are the questions that I have in this draft. As you see, there are not that many. There are only nine. It's not going to take some a long period of time to have this sent out. It would be sent out through the district's email system to the employee's district email account, but the survey results would be captured by us in our office. So that's the template that we'd like you to work on for a bit. Any questions about this before you dive into your group discussion on it? It was that clear?
Really? Oh, yeah.
All right, why don't we take like 20 minutes for you as a group to go through. I'll leave this up on the board. If you access the live binder on your digital device, you'll be able to go through it there. But just walk through in order and see what the group says. And I'll be bouncing around between the tables if anybody has any questions about the survey mechanism.
Drew, can you grab your laptop?
I'm Mr. Primitive.
Seems pretty straightforward. Mm-hmm. With regard to how they have the groups filled out on the first question, is that
elementary,
middle, high school teacher, special education?
Lost George here.
So what I would look at is I'm looking at later, the first one where it's asking who you are, and I'm going to change the word special to honor for.
So I can't answer that?
You guys do Encore. Okay. Because if we are using Encore, I think that's going to break. It'll help people automatically look and see.
This is the one where you have to rank the order of
You're quite correct.
Starting in the top and just kind of going through them and saying,
okay, so George, where I'm starting us off, you know, where at the end is, I'm looking at, and then special, okay, so I think special education teacher is a very easy way for people to know that that's who they are. Specialist teacher, you know, when you look at a specialist teacher, elementary they're Encore, and in middle school they're Encore.
High school they are
four, and then do five, eight. But then you look at like, Encore/electives.
Or maybe that's a question.
Encore teacher/electives.
I'm sorry, did you say special ed was okay?
I think special ed, I think,
would be okay. I question looping.
But school psychologist, I wonder about looping school psychologist. I think that's more student services.
We get that.
Like a student service piece. Because a student service would put it in there.
Just going to talk to you like, you'll say the three things you told me for and nurse could be.
Well, okay, so that's where it gets tricky. And when you look at other professional educators, well, if you put a counselor and a librarian there, when you look at elementary, they're teaching
regular ed teachers.
They are both educators in elementary where they're part of the encore, so they're teaching classes.
I would think that
the middle school,
but it being as most of them went from the elementary school, and
but they're not actually responsible to teach a 30-minute class.
It's similar to how I teach guidance officers.
What would be a
lessons, but it's not.
If that's true, what would be an example of a
can I make a because what seems strange to me is that question one says I'm an elementary school teacher, middle school, high school, and then you go down and it says work location, elementary school, middle school, high school, district office. So why isn't question one
in their lens
a teacher?
They just might respond.
Elementary encore, elementary student services.
Well, no, what I mean, like, how about you just categorize like. Regular ed teacher, special education teacher, student services, because in question two then it separates out where what level you're at.
Well, sometimes there's a benefit that we want to.
Regular education teacher, special education teacher.
Because it seems to be, I mean, basically what we're looking at.
Need an intervention because I'm sick and tired of opening these and never having to go inside.
I think that would be good.
Intervention doesn't need a home.
But here's the thing with school populations too.
You don't want it to get.
And I'm not saying that can be a
how many people have been there a long time.
I think a lot of us are as worried about it as just being able to say, look at the things that we do that is not the same as a classroom teacher.
I'm curious too, and the thing to keep in mind is the outcome, like what we're looking for.
And that would be all the reading, it would be all the math.
Oh, okay.
It maybe would be the like elementary all the so I think it would be going across the district.
But keeping in mind too, like the outcomes we're going to get from the survey, you know, if we're going to like Clark
Schmidt, the results, or.
Regular ed teacher.
You have other special, other professional educator because.
Not yet. Let me. Combines the elementary, middle, and high school. Combines those three into one.
So that would be like a core teacher, right? Like somebody responsible for the core.
Right. So would you pull out? Would it be just
regular?
I mean, I know that's the terminology.
Specials and special educators. I mean,
we kind of we talk a lot about. And I'm like, okay, so who didn't from
other tasks? Well, now it's the other career.
This is not
about professional need the other professional educator.
I feel like somebody does
where would
I think you do because a librarian, I don't know where a librarian is. A librarian is probably not an intervention.
That's right, but a librarian at the elementary would be considered an encore. At the high school, the middle school, so they could actually, if there's other, they could go in their own thing there.
I wonder what percentage of our teachers are that 16 and above? Is there... Is it really high? Because then, yeah, it makes sense to definitely break.
Just would include
and break it up even more, right?
Well, it doesn't matter which order.
I don't know if I have a good.
I think it kind of split up. There's more younger teachers than you think.
I don't.
They're old.
We've had a last year we had 75 new teachers.
Irrelevant.
But is it as many of them?
We want to have elementary, middle, high school. Or does the grade? Are the questions there about that there are a lot of?
No, they have examples.
It may have.
But in the district too.
So four to ten, maybe, how about 11 to 20?
Or what are, what do they go by? SAD?
Here's 15 things that are called academic.
Definitely over.
That's the leader.
I shouldn't go to the change.
Come on, SLP?
There are people that have been teaching.
SLP, and then what do you talk about? What is the work here? One of them teacher.
What's that?
Lisa Lurkier.
I don't know, we'll ask that.
Is that, okay, yeah. Well, some of them have like.
Depending upon the answer, then we might have.
Encore is going to have art, music, bio, tech.
Yeah.
Kind of a thing. I don't know what else they have. And then the extension, of course.
If someone's coming here with.
And we probably have the same.
Now there are one each thought.
Versus.
Yeah, it's just, yeah, the structure of question.
That's what I'm saying.
They still have a couple of the models had 5, 10, or 15.
The guy would be, this is my second year district, but it's my ninth year teacher. So I'm a second year teacher, so.
Counselors, social worker, teaching, or years in education.
So what about.
What about advanced learning specialists?
We did 2 questions.
Another person that never has a.
They're an intervention.
So they put ALS there.
Yeah, and we can.
Yeah, and we also have.
DID.
Learning disabilities, bilingual.
The guy still uses that acronym, so that's why.
So.
So now I have to think of all my friends.
System, right?
Their jobs.
It's credits.
Because they're not technically intervention. But I think.
Interventionist would be. So we did take your title.
Right, but what about bilingual?
It's up here too, I think, right?
The only question I would have is because of the longevity model.
Yeah, salary.
So then maybe at 4, you want to put bilingual.
It's a standard step and lane, right?
1 to 4, 5 to 9, 10 credits, 14, 15 plus.
Yep.
And it could be what they see themselves as.
In the alternative compensation models, there were 2 of them that had longevity models. 5, 10, and 15 were benchmarks.
Each one is a little different.
That's something that we.
It's like a bilingual.
That's more of a question.
Or teacher, or ESL, the high school might be more of an intervention.
Good.
Anything else on demographics?
Well, that didn't take us long.
Okay.
Well, and then I like pick this idea of let's just.
I mean, I guess that there's a lot of questions.
Like, educators' evaluation. Okay, so you were worried about like, should be reworded. There would be people that would,
educator effect.
That you would end up with over educator. Is that going to happen when you're
so that you know officers as an option? Because
there is. I don't know what
you're still working about. You're still working
in on these. You got the credit.
Right. So I'm thinking like when
well, but like Linda Levy is she's a teacher.
That's what I'm wondering. Is that really
I put her in special ed.
When we saw from the different examples of that.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Now you're doing it.
And where would you
maybe that's why they have it. Maybe that's why.
They're not our staff.
Is anybody else
by that?
I audibly
by asking this question.
I was sitting at my desk and I went.
How do your students rank you? How do your
I guess I.
So we want to make sure that they know
they put it out for computer
all the people that are up for a
position.
Yeah.
Iowa
was
science.
And then the
community
is
30
days on your job. So if it gets too small,
it's identifiable. What about people who share between
elementary and school? Elementary and school.
Yep. Yep. Q2 would be elementary.
That's another good point. I guess 3 years. I would do elementary. Do elementary / EC.
Yes.
Right. There you go.
I mean, again, we are okay. I mean, everybody feels like
they
have
a whole alphabet.
We're starting to answer
the
question.
We did start to answer
the question. I'm going to ask her what her thoughts are. I always think of EC as a
good thing. It's a good thing. Is this something that you have a certain amount of care?
Then we have middle, and then we have
this is
high school, and then the / part.
There's a big difference between 15
high school is
high school. We're high school.
Okay.
This is the level. It's not. I mean, it's just all elementary, all middle school, all high school.
Maybe at 15.
I will
build on the salary scale.
I have a hard time.
I think
that's
that
is that because that means because it says initial educator professional
advanced. Yeah,
five or six schools. She's a PT.
I mean, that means
for a diagnostician,
that
teams are right. Those are the two we were thinking of.
Every time
I'm thinking of
a
Yeah, maybe I'll just call ourselves
districts.
So I'll just add that.
I just have to ask, but what was our time on this?
20 minutes.
I just want to make sure.
Yep. Okay, here we go. Let's get to the survey.
So my only thing I want to think about with demographics is I think it's weird that the cutoff is 16 years or more.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
I think that's bizarre.
So what do you want it to do?
I think they're okay up until that.
However, they could take it into.
I think, but then right there, you're isolated.
But isn't that 1 to 3 years?
Yeah.
It's 1 to 3.
Let's do less than 1 to 3 if we want. If we're worried about people.
I mean, I would do like a 20, a 21 to 25, and then a 26 plus or something like that. I don't know. To me, it's weird. I can't do everybody.
We should ask about
0 to 3.
I think it might not even tease that out.
Negatively, but it.
What would you fill out
here? I'd put.
I think that's
one for you.
I would want to
then you get like.
Okay, then let's do one.
Okay, 1 to 3. But then do you like write some stuff?
I think we leave what's on there. I think 4 to 9, 10 to 15,
16 to 20.
Well, that would have to do with your
21 to 25, 26 plus.
They're really willing.
And then I would just do 26 plus.
I think we want to. I think it's interesting to hear.
Yeah, I think 16 is.
You can dive in based on
that we are going
to look at. Good. All right.
Show the people who were serving that we care about everybody. You know, because it's a bunch of readers.
Yeah, that's fine.
I worry about having three open-ended questions.
I do think they should be at the end because things might come up during the other questions that we want to share more information.
So now, look at the link and see if there's anything you want to add or delete.
Additional duties, I think, is
broad. Oh, yeah, those are
I'm going to say it's a bad word.
As an English teacher,
I'm going to
reword it.
I think that,
I know, the question is, please rank the following factors based on their compensation system. Are they asking people, I mean, what I assume they're asking people
is, percentage
of your compensation package should be based on additional duties, additional skills? I mean,
it's hard to number something 1 to 10.
So is the color bars what it
shows? So, but I just think it's
she's ranking the following factors. 10 numbers is a lot of numbers to have to think about.
But this one's just I'm writing on the notes. I said, should it even be on the chart?
If you have 10 questions, exactly what does it mean? Okay, so is that an 8 or a 7? You know, it's like, it's that little stuff that...
That's because there are 10.
This is important.
Because you can't rank three things as 10 or 5 years. You have to give it a position.
Because there's a couple of those that I would say, they're not that important. But now I'm going to have to give it a 9-10.
It looks like maybe it is.
But I'm going to tell you, it sounds like the district is already thinking about these things.
Vicki, this is our second meeting. We're not thinking about anything.
Well, but where did this come from? Okay, so it came from something. I mean, other districts, this is what other districts rank thing on. So, either, if we don't include these in here,
well, some of these we might
have
then, since we're not
right, but if we don't include them, then...
It's hard for us to get a base analysis against
yes, of what the other... So basically, by not including them,
we can make the argument.
By default, I think we're throwing them out.
That have filled
because,
and we would have asked the staff on how they feel about it.
Right.
And then we won't feel comfortable talking to them. Right.
So that's what I'm saying. So, okay, so I...
Believe me.
I don't mean it that way. What I was trying to say is that as someone who read the compensation packages from other districts, and I would like to say, I don't know who the hell can understand those compensation packages. I know. My response is, I didn't understand any of them. Without a lot of thought, and that to me is wrong. But I mean, yeah, like there's something wrong with it. But when I look at these, all of these things were in those compensation packages.
But some of them we've already ruled out.
Well, what have we ruled out?
The evaluation.
Have we?
With that being said, we need to have it.
I don't know.
Professional development activities.
Using it as a means for evaluating compensation, not using it, have it rule them out. But it doesn't mean we're using it as a means of how to determine compensation.
Teachers who have been trained to do things above and beyond their, like I'm thinking of the CPM trainer, trainer, teacher trainer.
I mean, because to me, when I look at this list, somewhere it needs to be, like how well I do my job. Like, do I do my job? A lot of this stuff is about stuff outside of just my classroom job. So I don't know how else to say it besides educators' evaluation.
What we're asking is,
right, so
that's stuff on here that is primarily my job, that's outside of my day job.
Yeah, this is trying to find out what people value.
So the first one, if I were taking this,
would you rank these factors?
And for example, with strength and
strength. Yeah, reword the question because they want to know. And it would have should
well,
where does length of
really
service
not same factor
out? If it's no. A good degree, or as priority in the middle and the bottom, where does advanced degrees fit?
So here's the question. Is this question getting at individuals' compensation, or is this question trying to ask as a district when we create a compensation model, is this as a district?
That's why the question is a system.
People might struggle with
compensation system.
Okay.
So you worded that much better than they just said that.
You need to write that down.
We need to find a succinct way to sum up what you said.
The good thing he's taking notes.
Yeah, I'm the one with my pen was there.
Something along the lines of
set your cell phone on record.
As you consider the district's approach to creating a compensation model,
math and biology or whatever,
you have to have a coercion.
Which of the 10 factors?
How about rank and importance?
Yeah, do you believe to be the most important?
Right. Rank and importance from top to bottom.
Yeah, and then one is the most important, 10 is the least important.
Rank the importance of these factors.
Oh, yeah.
Is it just too leading? Because now you're planting seeds.
I'm not a wordsmith. Leave that up to the English teachers.
Exactly. I agree. I'm intervention. I get to play that card.
So here's my only question. I don't understand. So if I was doing this survey, I would understand everything except licensure for PI 34.
Yeah, I don't know what that is.
I don't know what that is. Probably because I got a license 25 years ago.
PDP.
I think we changed that.
This option, I don't care. Yeah.
Some districts have bumped once you've gone.
I think, no, I don't.
You know, or this one
I don't think so. You're right.
I don't think about my
past.
You're right. We've been looking at different models. Things are starting to pop.
And if you already are a master teacher,
that's a good point.
I don't know. Under what
do you think people would have done?
And then you could have.
Well, I don't know. I don't really understand the PDP system because
it's so new.
You can be a master teacher.
It's
kind of like the national
if the PDP, the idea is that you renew your license every 5 years and you have to do it.
Yeah, I know. I've been a mentor, and so I know that system. I just don't understand.
It's hard to aggregate the data, isn't it?
I think it's another way to include the opinion on everything.
But I think it is important to aggregate because if you have a PDP, you do not have to go around
getting aggravated
classes. How you get the response that you want.
The way our model has worked in the past is you have to take the credit. So you'll have people who are under the PDP who get nothing for that. But they have the same credits that don't help them with their license.
Yeah, I know.
But I think you have to
take things
one at a time and say
A or an A.
Okay. Additional duties.
Like 90% rank.
I don't like the way that went.
Early retirement or.
So that's question. So that's a suggestion. We need more clarification on it.
Those are the factors.
Additional duties would be like, make sure.
That makes sense to me.
But are these additional duties that everybody has the opportunity to do?
But I'm wondering.
I
understand.
Those are additional duties. I'm not a curriculum committee.
Okay, I think putting those examples down, because otherwise if I look at this, like mentor, peer coach, curriculum writing and research are not anything in elementary that any of us would consider ourselves doing.
Where did you see them?
Scroll down. These are in more detail. And these are, it's the templates example, so we need to specify it to our district.
Yeah, because when I read these, just here, that doesn't make sense to me.
Because it's not our district, so these things don't apply to us.
Wait, what doesn't apply to us?
So this other district had mentor, peer coach, had curriculum.
Well, we have mentor, peer coach.
We do, but we need the rest of it.
How would you call that curriculum renewal?
Really? Curriculum writing renewal?
I don't see anything for one, two, three.
Research we don't do, but at the high school we do curriculum writing all the time.
But in the elementary we wouldn't, so is it that?
Oh, elementary they do curriculum.
Well, we do curriculum renewal, but we really don't write our own curriculum.
I see.
If we look at that research,
but improve.
There you go.
What does it mean by opportunity? And there's going to be some people who
We're on slide 6. We actually have to go back.
Right.
So I'm just telling you,
we're not people have already gone through and they're going to have a great idea.
Well, but that is the, I
think
when I was is that what it is?
It's got an element in it.
But they still have.
Oh, I know.
PPIS,
I'll be tonight. You did a great job.
These are things we could go through.
What they think is important.
So I just think
I've always just kind of done additional
additional skills and say,
I think those salaries in total sense.
I know that
they need to be flexed.
But they're okay.
Eight is the exact opposite. It's what challenges, what worries you, and then what challenges, 1 to 3 challenges.
I want my health benefits because my husband makes enough for our family. So that's completely different than me, who's looking at a salary schedule.
No race cars?
I think Eric was just going to focus on what worries you and what do you hope for. Like, are they going to see that?
I meant 30 years. Holy cow.
Not math, right?
Oh, man. Kentucky's crazy. It's not that crazy.
Credit.
Seven
will be very similar. So I hope for a career path.
That would probably be a
Potentially,
I don't know that they have to get additional
certification.
Probably additional certification.
The question is, do you want to leave educator evaluation on there or not to find out what people feel about it?
I think we should leave it on to find out what people think.
Because it's pretty broad.
I mean, I assume it's going to come up low, but I still think that there are people that feel strongly about it.
The other thought is, many people use the survey as a tool to try to interpret what the board or the people are trying to do. So if you put that in there, there'll be some people who are living life in a negative zone who think that you're planning on compensating based off of that. So you do open the door that says, oh, they asked about it, so I'm just mean they're planning on doing it.
But what is, aren't we going to use the evaluation?
Are you looking at number 8 still?
Evaluated every 3 years.
Yeah.
We're not going to look at the evaluation. I mean, wouldn't that
be the same?
Not
to determine where you fall on the salary schedule.
Not to determine that, but
I don't say that.
That's
it's
already
like
there.
It's more of a
people
job performance versus a job.
So I would say what worries you.
Yeah.
I don't know what you're
going to do.
That's pretty basic.
It would not be based on the evaluation.
Well, that's up to you, but my concern is that there will be some people who don't focus on not paying attention to the local, who may be thinking that we're thinking about doing that, even though we're
exactly.
But I don't know. I agree with you. I don't know if I have it. You can maybe ask Bob and see what comes up. happened to that?
It's like you kind of got to look at the model when the detail is there. There was a performance or pay.
In the last...
There wasn't a guarantee that if somebody's improvement.
I do think too that question.
So in other words,
it's possible you hear what challenges people have seen.
Which we think you would have
to in the priority. What do they see as challenges versus process?
Since we're asking you to choose one, because the SLO is something that is out of my control.
We can separate
if we're testing a child today and whatever. Me doing my job is within my control.
Right, right. So
developed at one of the top one to that by looking at all the different separate pay codes that we've given.
I understand you want the information, but how much is this a survey? Also,
the different
things that I mean, SLO would be check them out.
Educators' evaluation is that educators' effectiveness, because educators' effectiveness is based on SLO. I don't think that would be
important. What about educator?
And I should, because I'm up for evaluation.
If I wouldn't understand that, if I were taking the survey, what is educator practice?
Yeah, but I think people that come from other districts, like myself, can lend some information from people who have been here who don't. So maybe
this is where we're all talking and listening. But I did have a concern that I don't want people to think that because we asked the question, we're planning on doing
it. I also don't want to put that in
the drop or the paid practices are administered consistently.
I think the licensure needs to be just rewritten.
I don't know.
I read this, I look at it, and I go, well, one of the things that we is that
the marketing incentive is hard to staff. What is it that everyone keeps calling that?
I don't like the
virtual stuff about it, though, within the district.
But
the education.
Yeah, it's, okay. But it's marketed.
Now, it does that mean it's going to affect
so just,
my pay?
I think it
should
would
have that print.
That's what I would have when I got it. But I'm also not in the classroom, so
you want to,
guys might have a better feel for how teachers respond to that. But I know when I read it, I absolutely didn't think about
that.
National Board for Professional Teaching Standard Master Teacher. Isn't that the same as what we did way up there?
Some districts,
we've
never
done it.
Some
districts have two good credit for your National Board certified.
It's different from having your master's.
Correct.
So that would be an additional degree. That's something totally different.
I would say.
Well, my wife goes to lunch. They go to meetings at Mars. You know, we have lunch meetings.
They have lunch meetings. They want reworded National Board certification.
Yeah. I mean, if they worked for it, why not?
Yeah, or when they're gone, I just stay home and push them.
I can tell you.
That's what ADKL is,
everything.
Yeah, ADKL. And then
just go to school.
So, like, as a counselor, I can
ask the teacher.
Yeah, oh, you're on the show. You don't know what
it will be. You have a script for the whole
government. What do you hope to see in a new company?
Yeah, that's
right.
And we'll see what the
next one is. Not
even referring to the say this, they might say this.
Once we develop
it's kind of like reading
sounds like it is everywhere.
So should we go on to 10 or is it just 9?
I had some. There are a couple that might be questions that I brought that I thought I'd run by you guys.
Do we talk about the pay practices or administrative for employees?
Does anybody know the answer to that? There's a question I'd ask, do you understand the system as it is?
One thing I really like,
probably not important.
When a question time gets so long, then I just start
to... It was one of their main objectives. Everybody loved that was one. Make sure that we have a clear path from starting base to veteran pay.
Elementary?
And then I think there's...
So there's really nothing...
Wait,
and maybe
you guys have recess duty.
Seeing the future a little bit.
I'm not a classification.
Professional development.
It's only two. How would I do it though if I have kids?
I'm satisfied with the pay and benefits offered by the district.
And then you have to count on weather.
Who's asking for the information? So it's this compensation committee to help you with your mission. And then also a couple of things that Bob is going to talk about that hopefully will also not only be in the email, but we might choose to embed them in the survey itself. And these are things that the board had decided before the committee was
initiated. We were just talking about it at our table as well. And there are some concerns, again, which are going to come up time and time again. And just to real quickly paraphrase, the board has made some decisions. First of all, when the new compensation model comes into place, we're not going to be reducing the base pay. So we're not looking at a compensation model that's going to go in a negative direction from where you're currently at right now. So that's a concern that everybody has had. Pay based on test scores. There's a lot of concern, especially looking at some of the compensation models that you've already looked at there. There's some concerns that your pay is going to be based on test scores. That's not something we're looking at or considering. And then pay will be based on, I don't want to say principal evaluation, but that's notes here on evaluations from that. We're not looking at a merit pay system at this particular time. So those are the concerns of the board. It's tried those questions. They've tried to answer at this time. So we want to work on a compensation system and don't have to worry about those particular sticking points. Questions?
There was one question, and I think in one group, that was about if you are in a plan for improvement, that could impact a pay increase.
Yes.
So that's a nuance to the piece. So in other words, we're not going to be, there wouldn't be any kind of like pay on the basis of I got a 3.5 and you got a 3.3, so I get more money. We're not doing that. But if you're on a plan for improvement, it's possible that you wouldn't get a pay increase that everybody else would get. That's possible. It's not, that hasn't been determined, but that I think that was one of the caveats. Right now in the district, I think there are three people in the district.
The concern, and I'm going to go to contract law, and Bob, you can correct me. So with a contract, we can't renew your contract if we offered you less money than you made before.
That is correct. You have to either voluntarily agree to the lower salary or your contract has to be non-renewed, and then they have to offer you a contract. So even if the pay system said, oh, Bob, you can't do this, your pay's going to go down. If that's my core salary for my teaching, that can't happen. That's separate and distinct from you had me as building chair or curriculum chair or something one year. You took that extra duty away. That isn't tied to your individual contract. But when I walk through the various groups, I think what Bob just said is important to reiterate, both in the text of the email that accompanies the survey, and then perhaps we also think about when we talk about your concerns for a new system, please note that the following will not happen. So I don't put in, well, my concern is that the board's going to use student learning outcomes. And we get a bunch of those responses, even though the board said we're not going to use student learning outcomes. So it resurfaces again in the survey. That makes sense.
Just like we were talking about here before, if we put the question in there, sometimes people read it and interpret the wrong way. Sometimes by your own fears because it's a change in the system. Everybody's nervous. Everybody's afraid. I mean, I don't know how much more personal a paycheck. It's very personal to everyone. So I think it's important as we send messages out and survey as a message that we send out a good message. So I'll quit talking, let you guys keep working.
Do people need more time to finish this, or do you gone through all the questions?
We have not gone through all the questions.
Yeah, let's start.
How many tables would like 5 more minutes?
Well, then that means that other people have already
answered. Okay. Where they aren't overthinking it.
Okay, what were his questions?
So we can either go to the open-ended questions and base pay. Do you have any ideas on that? Or is that even legal?
It was I phrased it like this because I've been to a lot of professional development.
That one was specific.
I'm going to say you can go down. Disagree or disagree, although I've looked at those already.
In the past,
I've actually looked at
that were worth your time or something like that.
Fairly good.
Yeah. And, maybe that's, now's okay. Not the time for that, but in so many of these plans,
I mean,
you know, the
here's
point
what I'm
going to
tell you.
Development
the
it,
no
you know,
opinion,
is
like pay practices
that
are
in my head,
administered
I'm thinking,
consistently
well,
for all employees.
We're just going to have to go to all these workshops. And
my response would be that I don't know.
To jump through hoops, and it won't be meaningful.
I mean, I don't know the answer to that. So no opinion.
Maybe again, this is later.
I mean, to me,
counterpart
or like, I don't know. I mean, can I don't know be a response? I don't know. I mean, no,
because
what I would say is I have an opinion about it. My opinion is I don't know.
3 years, you go back to the beginning.
I would say that
back to the base.
Before 2011, I would have said yes, that it's administered.
They are not being compensated for
it. But I'm not sure that that would be
a lot of time to do it.
Curriculum creation. Although some may say that's part of your base pay, and these might all be thrown in there.
And I don't know what leave time means.
Are you talking about
parents, anything extra beyond?
I just combined.
And I'm not sure that would match.
FMLA or
I think
they
all
came
leave
from
up.
People I was talking okay. about it.
Just to get a list of
so maybe you should say
doing.
Leave time.
What are teachers doing well right
sick,
now?
Sick personal FMLA.
They're not being compensated for.
Are those the only
leaves? I don't know.
I don't know. Those are the only three I know.
What's the other one that you take off?
FMLA is federal law.
I don't have my answer.
Yeah. So sick and personal.
I don't have any plans.
That's it. It's not even sick. It's just reimbursable.
It doesn't come
off. In that is
so I haven't looked at that.
Oh, that's true.
And
we all have to mark
that
I
have
the
preparation and being professional.
I understand my benefits. Are we talking like health? And
yeah, I don't like that question. I'd rather ask the question about how people feel about the health.
Yeah,
that's above with I'm satisfied with the pay and benefits.
Going to push a person into special ed.
I think those should be separated out.
So I'm satisfied with the pay, and then the other questions of I understand can be I satisfied.
It took me a couple years to find a position.
I don't think I know how to. I think know how to use them is a completely separate issue.
But I was like, well, I was told this, so they're really helpful.
That's a good point.
Yeah, and I don't, and I'm not sure it's really important. I think it's part of a compensation package. Like if people don't know how to use their benefits, that's a human, it's a human resources issue.
So maybe just
drop that question.
Yeah. So I would just separate out.
I understand my benefits and get healthier is problems or questions about them. So the last two drop.
Yeah, I don't know what those have to do with.
I mean, I think they're good information
like
the district wants
like
to know that at some point.
For after this one, then here is like, I'm going to have to, they're going to
all be like Common Core.
Okay, great.
So there's that fear out there that
yeah,
if you get the certification,
yeah.
I think it's going to need the a district can
just
tell
you.
Otherwise,
we turn people
down.
Now
you're
going to
work. And then they're not professionals anymore.
What'd you say?
And you're talking about leaders
yeah,
of the
I'm,
district.
Yeah,
or
yeah I'm
not
sure.
And you're talking about creation.
Unless you have an idea.
Those are things that teachers are doing well. They're in on the weekends doing it.
Well, I think question four is interesting. What are the top 1 to 3 strengths of the last negotiated professional educator compensation?
Saving the district money.
So here's the thing. That question is asking for a compensation system. So do we want a question about compensation? Or do you want a question about salary?
Salary. I think we have to have something about the salary schedule. What are the top 1 to 3 strengths?
Yeah, and share it.
But here's what I'm going to tell you.
Which I think is the I mean,
by
it's
asking it
issue. It's not
and limiting it to salary,
it doesn't
one of the issues
to do with coaching
that
and mentoring and leadership. And that's what so
going on for part-time employees is they're going to lose
it's very hard
their health insurance.
To beat on
compensation.
How to measure that?
It's compensation.
But I guess it's what I'm asking.
Right. I think it needs to be compensation.
What are teachers doing that they're not, well, that they're not being compensated for? And then because one of the tenets of the first meeting was for districts to use their strengths
package?
And it should be organic and homegrown. Well, what are our strengths? You know,
we
why don't we ask
package?
That question? And I know that was,
and then it's the same
they're
question five.
What do teachers think are the strengths
look
of this district?
How can we
what
do you hope for? I hope for world
that's
peace.
I'm just trying to use what they've
I think that's an option.
going to say, I would delete the question, what do you hope for? I would start with, given the changes taking place in public education.
Master's degree to even get to the top end.
Or within your grade level or within your building.
Like, after a certain point, no matter how many years of teaching or other professional
changes, let's see what that sounds like without that.
Actually, it sounds really good.
Well, it is, yeah.
Education.
To an extent, right?
Funding a tutor.
Oh, we got to change, negotiate professional educator compensation system.
All right, well, why don't we get this moving, and we'll start with question one of the demographics.
Okay.
And I'll start with our table over here.
Oh, yeah, no problem.
See, do we have a spokesperson about what you guys actually would like to have for some...
I have notes as well, they're also like, I can share out.
All right, everybody, we got Lori's sharing some feedback.
How much resources are there? And you've got notes over there.
Why don't we start with question by question? As we go through, so I'll go to each one and rotate around. We'll start with question one of the demographics as to what potential amendments you would like to see in the survey instrument, the demographics question.
Can you talk to me?
Yeah.
Okay. The only thing we had really identified was that we wanted to make sure that on the special teachers, we identified tech ed, because we thought there would be confusion as to how they would categorize themselves.
That's a wording piece. We had it listed as specials, electives, encore.
We're way more complex than
you. Oh, yeah. No, but Bob, I'll just turn mine in.
Let's see what everyone thinks.
It was reworked. The whole thing was reworked.
We rewrote it.
Do you really want to know? I mean,
yeah.
Okay. So take away what was there, and it's going to change to regular education core teacher, and in parens also bilingual. Special education, and in parens, SLP, pick another one, and then et cetera. So that, right. Student services, and then in parens, counselor, social work, et cetera.
Psychologist.
Yeah. Interventionists, and in parens, reading, math, advanced learning, et cetera. Am I going? You okay?
Yeah.
Encore / elective teacher, and in parens, art, music, PE,
tech ed.
And then other professional educators, and then parens, library, nurse, etc.
And then
nurse won't be part of it because they're in PSSP.
Library,
okay.
Etc. No.
library in the elementary would be
okay. What?
And no, so we completely got rid of elementary, middle, and high school, and that question, because the next question asks you what level you're at. So that was redundant. So we fixed your survey.
if we segregate out so much, then the fear of the person taking the survey might be, can they pick who I am answering the question?
For instance, the interventionist, I think we probably had maybe 20 staff members.
Yep,
or so.
I agree.
And so if only half of them fill it out, and we have 10 people responding in that group, when you start desegregating the data, I'm really worried about them feeling really called out. So, but because we take out nurses, maybe we could blend interventionists in with other professionals, such
there
as
you go.
Your
library.
Library. And
so now it's library and intervention, though.
Yeah.
Well,
interventionist / other
librarian.
Professionals. / librarian. No. Interventionist / other professionals. Other professionals.
We could all just put any of our resource teachers into that other category. Would be my thought, which that would pull in your ELL and bilingual, which are more of a resource teacher. It would broaden that category
okay that?
Enough.
You okay with that?
Intervention / resource teacher.
Intervention / resource.
Really.
Okay.
I think then you've got a bigger mass that might be a little less.
I think we need to be careful about getting too wordy about all the descriptions of the different categories of teachers.
turn people off from trying to find where they belong.
Right. And then balance on the other side is, we talked about, is the first question, they want to make sure that I identify myself in this group so I feel like answering the next couple of questions.
So like as an interventionist, most surveys that I take, I don't belong to. So when I open it up, it says regular ed. Well, I'm not regular ed. And then it says special ed. Well, I'm not special ed. Then it says
encore.
Well, I'm not
encore. So then you fall into other.
Well, there's not an other or the other. They'll give like something generic, and it's like, well, that's not me. So just making sure that when the people take it, that they feel like they belong to start with. That we are looking at all the places, not just
four. Or what is your district license? Are you 1A elementary?
All others.
Give them up.
You're crazy.
Well, we had regular ed, special ed. Our third category was specials, electives, encore, which is that whole extra elective area. And then we had other, and in our mind, other captured student services, interventionists, library, media, all of those extra positions that don't fall into the first three categories. And then we had a second question, which was elementary, middle, high school, or district, because we do have a number of staff that don't fall into one of the three main levels because they provide district or broad-based services across the whole K-12 or pre-K-12.
Can I just add to the elementary, since we went to that, you went to that question too? We had elementary / EC / 4K.
Thank you, George.
Let's stay on question for a moment. Then.
Get it?
This is kind of just fascinating about the first three tables that we'll get to table four. Regular ed, and then we'll put an example of what a regular ed board teacher is, special education. Wait,
that's what my sister's going to ask.
Well, we just have
we're just going to pass.
Guidance, social work.
Because I think people would.
School counselors.
Yeah, they're not guidance.
Well,
we should have a question too.
I have a whole philosophy behind it.
People just change shit whenever they feel like.
Yeah, for a reason. I understand that. You really want to know.
We have a clarification from middle school and making sure in parentheses it says 5th through 8th grade.
But that's a question.
We had that for
is that question 2?
Yeah, we're on
that's
question.
That's question 2.
Well,
Dr.
Johnson put down number 1.
It was on question 1.
You're pulling rank over here.
Oh, it was. That's why. He was confused.
It was a duplicate.
Okay, sorry. When we get to middle school, yes, we'd like to look at that as 5.
Because they're not sure where they belong either.
As it should be.
Do these 5 categories for question 1, do you think this gives us good demographic data?
It's okay. I'm just going off your notes, my friend.
Narrow and focus that it gets personally identifiable, being large enough groups. Okay. All right, so we'll stick with that for question 1, demographic changes. Question 2, just to show you what question 2 was again. Question 2, we asked the work location. Start in the reverse order that we did, so you guys get to start on.
Yes. Okay. So we'd like to see middle school as 5 through 8. And then perhaps elementary as pre-K through 5 through 4.
Four.
Pre-K through 4. Just so that people know where their home is. Because I know the 4K services are provided off an elementary site, so.
But we have some on-site, too.
We do.
We have
and, right.
Yeah,
and we have some EC on-site.
So if we put it in parentheses, they'd know pre-K is there.
Do we want to have
they would fall under pre their
but for location, not
for location.
District office or
district?
Yep. Just district.
District-wide.
District-wide.
So now we're.
Are there going to be instructions for if I'm 50% at one place and 50% at another?
Actually, question 1 was.
Are they going to put themselves as district?
We need to get into right hand and left hand.
What do you want to do?
Are you a
Yeah, you could say district and in print say more than one level. Multiple levels.
Multiple levels.
Because it's going to be three elementary schools.
Are we saying district wide would be in parentheses multiple levels? Not a separate category.
They're only working with people with kids with IEPs. I never know what happened. Like today at the math meeting, I mean, we talked about the rubric.
So that would be traveling teachers that go to multiple levels, or it could be our diagnosticians who work out of DAC.
Yep. OTs, PTs.
0, 1, 2, 3, 3.5, and 4 is the hard one.
Which is using a Word doc if you think math is wrong.
I'm a fan of the Word doc.
I hate Google Docs. George is always so happy when you use math.
Bane of my existence.
I would die without Google
Docs.
I
thought you
without Word documents.
I can't even do Word documents. I just discovered that. And
it takes too much work to share.
People get mad at school when they're like, you put that in a Word doc?
No, we're good.
We're good.
Not yet.
We're good because we're moving on to question.
Three.
Oh, three of them.
But I'm a big idea.
Question three, years of service in the district. Tabitha.
We'll start. So, so we liked the less than 1 year, 1 to 3 years, and the 4 to 9, I think it was. But then we'd like the final three categories to be 10 to 14, 15 to 19, and 20 plus. And we have the extra added advantage that I have the list of all the employees that I looked up. And each of those three categories that I mentioned, 10 to 14, 15 to 19, and 20 plus, each have approximately 90 to 100 teachers in them for our district. Nice. So that represents 300 of our staff. And the remaining 260 or so will fall in that under 10 category. So I think it'll break out those thresholds kind of nicely. And we thought 20 plus year people might have a different response
than less than a year.
Don't present ours.
No, we're not going to present ours, but on the, one less than one and then 1 to 3,
yes.
Less than one, though, will be about 30 some. So could we do 1 to 3?
55.
Well, this year, but normally.
And typical years.
But George, you said because they had never been involved in knowing what the
keep it separate.
Contract was their answer.
Just know it's a little bit smaller group, but okay.
And, but helping with that issue of when you ask about what's working with the current system, they may not have a response to that because they don't have a historical reference.
Cool, all right.
And we kept it 1 to 3 because 3 years is the probationary cutoff.
No, I'm good. Good.
So we had lots of dialogue about this one.
Yep.
What she said.
Yeah. We also thought it might be helpful to have total years of teaching because some teachers come with several years experience from other districts, and so they wouldn't be maybe 1 or 2 years in our district, but they're certainly not an initial educator anymore. So perhaps we want to have in district and then total years of service.
Does it? To make a difference.
Actually, I would say total years of teaching experience.
Total years of teaching experience.
Service implies.
Because even if, you know, with the initial educator, 1 to 3 years, even if somebody came into the district with 6 years of experience, if they're still in state, they're not going to have to redo their initial educator license again. So,
could it just be experience, not necessarily teaching experience, just to make it more general?
I have 2 years.
Especially because some people may have switched
years experience.
Yeah.
Education experience, or whatever.
Yeah, educational where it captures paraprofessionals.
But they're not taking.
So
if you were 20 years at Verona and came here, you were.
I don't know. What's the correct terminology, George?
I think it should be a separate question.
What about licensed teaching experience?
I would leave teaching.
What if you say professional educator?
Licensed educator.
Licensed educator? Well, but then you're going to have people not teaching.
Yeah, they may have a license.
Oh, you made the second question.
Yeah, I made
I'm sorry,
a 3-8.
So this,
oh,
we
that's
have
a good idea.
A 3 experience, total years of teaching experience in the district.
What if you just say experience, because you're saying that you don't feel comfortable? Well, you wouldn't necessarily answer that question.
I mean,
because you're not a teacher.
Those of us that are not teachers but are definitely included within this category are very used to being referred to as having teaching experience. So, I mean, it comes down to semantics, and it's probably
well,
not worth the amount of...
Why teaching there and teaching there?
Yeah, exactly.
Would that make
so
sense?
If we keep referring to it as teaching, that's fine. Just pointing out that we're not all teachers.
Is everybody in agreement this would be a helpful field of data to ask? It's not going to take a person a long time. Well, I'm just here 15 years plus 4 years, wherever.
Yeah.
You're laughing.
Pretty much.
Yeah, it is. We have to add this and this and this.
Might take some people a while. I'm assuming everyone
knows that migrate frequently.
Yeah. Not our
math. Tears.
Okay, so then we'll add any other changes to this? Did any of the teams have anything, or do they agree with the
yeah,
that was a good idea.
I'm not even going to bother saying anything about our
campfire. Okay, now we get to top 1 to 3 strengths.
Bob?
Can I just ask a question?
Yeah, we have a suggestion too.
Well, go ahead. I have a question about how those things work in terms of when they go to do the data entry, do they actually only get like 3 buckets that they can write narrative information in?
That
yeah
way,
well, I'm just saying, you know, we hear that they want 3, but somebody could be writing a full, you know, essay.
No, I can make it so that you only have 3 text boxes to okay fill in.
And then how does that get aggregated? I mean, when we look at it, we just get a listing?
We'll get a list, and then we can run it on, we can say, highlight the words that appear most frequently or phrases that appear most frequently.
Okay.
So if length of service shows up or experience, we'll do it, say, analyze this question for a word count. And so years of service shows up. And I'm just guessing that's what's going to be there. Our career path, lifetime earnings, those words will pop up. And we'll get one of those little fancy little graph things, and we'll show all this words much bigger than the others. The groups have found that to be really helpful.
We were just kind of curious how all the open-ended questions
yeah,
work that
we
way.
We can do it. There's no magic to the 1 or 3. You can have more. You can have less than 1, I guess.
Our group's suggestion before we get to that is to move question 6 to question 4, the ranking question, because it could inform people, give them some ideas for the open-ended questions.
Questions 4 and 5 relocate to the after question.
Stuff like that.
And didn't we also
I thought we wanted to move
up both of the ranking questions.
Yes. And have the open ended
all at the end.
The end after they've kind of
so question
with some
so
of the concepts.
Would go, you would move up 4 and or I don't know, what would you move up?
Question 4.
Yes, you'd move up 6 and 9.
And then, right.
Well, we were going to move 9 up, too.
All right, so this table number 2's recommendation, we have this ranking, we'll get into what's ranked here later. The question 6 on a ranking, and 9 on a ranking.
Something to possibly think about by putting all the open-ended at the end.
People might bag on.
People might say, yeah, because I feel like, well, I've answered my strengths by ranking. I don't need to write anything. So, I mean, it's just, that's just something that came to mind.
Other thoughts from tables 3 and 4 on these marvelous amendments?
Hey. Team player here. It's our team. Team yellow.
George kind of got run over by the women, so it's not really his fault.
He's not getting a whole lot of support from me. He's on his own.
My thought initially, because I was thinking about what it would be like for me to take the survey, I would struggle with it initially. And especially if I wanted to get it done quickly, I'd probably have some answers, but they probably wouldn't be very thoughtful. So I love the idea of moving the question forward, because my suggestion was to have a menu, a box of possible responses, and also leave an area for open-ended. So I really like the idea. That's a long-winded way to say.
If we move, I think that eliminates the need to add a menu.
Yeah.
Because I worried about doing a menu that we would be leading people down that path, but if we move the ranking and that gets people's minds thinking, then we wouldn't have to do the menu as much.
No, that's a better idea.
And we can let the rest be free flow. But I would think we'd want to separate that ranking from question 9's ranking, because that's a very different piece.
Yeah.
We also talked, and people can add whether they think it's a good idea or not, but we talked about adding one other ranking question that's a little more detailed than the broad categories here, and that was whether we wanted to have like all of our current pay codes that we pay people extra things for, and whether we want staff to rank order those in terms of priority or importance. I don't know.
Can
what
you clarify that?
Yeah,
you
talk about
like extracurriculars,
indoor recess, and curriculum hourly rate, and teacher in a classroom substituting, and like I mean I've got a list
resource.
Of.
Additives, all that
not
stuff.
Additives. Those are coaching and all that stuff is separate. This is what people get hourly paid for doing extra little things. Regular ed gets some for IEP meeting attendance.
Is the purpose of this bigger ideas versus granularity? I mean, tell us the purpose of what we really want to learn from this, or what we want people to learn from. Because rather than getting, I think we're getting so far down into details that I'm wondering whether we're losing. What's the goal of the survey?
Well, it's first of all to get people familiar with what happened, right? So the survey is from, I think Bob summed up, the survey sends a message. So we have that email saying what the board has ruled out, this is what we're looking at, to provide guidance to the group. So if we get into one of these ranking questions and it's explained properly and something falls really low, like additional survey, then the group can say, well, perhaps this isn't where we want to spend our energies. So it does have that. To Tabitha's piece, if it doesn't take a lot of time, that can be a helpful item to be. Because if we're looking for, we have both, what some districts have done in order to fund a system, some have had budgetary space. So like a Sun Prairie had room underneath the revenue limits to spend more money. Others didn't. And so they looked at a prioritization and said, well, if we're spending all this money, and I'll use like River Falls as an example, they were spending a fair amount of money in their budget on compensating regular ed teachers for participation at IEP evaluations and re-evaluations. And so they surveyed and said, how do you view this overall in the system? If the district took those monies and put them into the whole pay system and you knew that once or twice a year you got called to an IEP meeting, you weren't going to receive any additional pay for being at that, but the district didn't, quote unquote, save that money, they distributed in the pay system, would that be something you're interested in? Now, they did that question itself at the committee level, but they saw how people valued certain things. So a different district, they have what I would view as a pretty healthy new lunch payment for new lunch supervision, but the staff really ranked that high as something to keep. So it was like, all right, we're going to leave that as it is, because that seems to be something that's working, and even though it might be higher than what we think it should be from a board's perspective or administration, we're going to leave it alone. So if you have an idea of those, we could put those 10 items down, and then perhaps you have some staff who it shows up in a paycheck but don't even know, oh, I get paid extra for doing X. I didn't know that. It showed up in my paycheck. That's it. I don't think we're going to add too much more from this, particularly if there's any ideas in combining some of these. I guess so far the only thing I see on this is I do have a concern about whether the open-ended questions will be answered if they're last. So I'd like to have something where, and maybe it's that question 9 about the satisfaction piece, that we show them they have a couple of text boxes to fill, and then something like this comes at the end. Mm-hmm. So they're spaced in between. That would be my only observation as far as the structure wouldn't want to end with three open ended in a row because I assume people just kind of paste the same things in each one. They'll be pressed for time or they won't have ideas. So did your group, Tabitha, talk about what an additional thing would be, or just be a listing and then we do a sort of ranking?
We just talked about it being a listing with a sort ranking, and what I said I could do is go back to the pay codes and payroll and look at what those pay codes are and kind of which ones are, I guess, most heavily utilized, because something that like three people do a year, I wouldn't even put on the list probably. But the things like indoor recess, the substituting, call a teacher in a classroom, those kinds of things where they're bigger areas, I could pull that list out of payroll pay codes and we could put that out there. At some point, I think it would be valuable. It was brought up by the group here. I agree that at some point we probably could use that data. The question is it now? Or to Don's point, if we wanted to keep this higher level, do we do another survey later? But I also think staff are going to be resistant to doing a second survey or a third survey down the road just to get more data. So if we have room to fit it in, it might be nice to get that up front so we have that going into all the conversation. So I could get those to you by tomorrow.
No, it would not take long, I think, for someone to do that. Mm-hmm. Now, we might get just things with numbers. There might be a handful of people who might want to say, or 20 people that's planning on ranking only because most staff aren't being recipients. And when we get to the things of how we rank, I think it's what was the first meeting, that National Board for Professional Teaching Standards. In every survey has come out ranked either last or next to last, and that's because so few people have attended or receiving it. So it's not really a value judgment necessarily, it's just the universe of people contemplating receiving it is so small. And that could be the same thing in your additional payments. So back to the, and I tell you, I don't have any problem adding that in. Does the group think that that might be valuable? We had 8 to 10. I've seen some heads say no, some say yes.
Is there a way to do it besides ranking?
Yeah.
Because I'm thinking like a lot of them wouldn't pertain to certain people, so it'd be hard to give it a 10, 9, 8, 7.
We talked in our group about the other ranking question being maybe easier for someone to answer if instead of having to rank those all in order, because we talked about like, well, what if I care about 3 of them and I don't care about 7 of them? Like, instead of for each question forcing an opinion, so... You know, one of them was like, what is it, like rank additional duties and have to like do the, you know, that bubble of like very important, someone important, I don't care. Or, you know, like somewhat not, or, you know, not important. Yeah.
Or so it forces people
yeah,
to
like
decide.
Yeah, like a 4-point scale or something on each. And then, I don't know.
I don't, there was concern that if I absolutely did not want this, I to be anything that was taken into consideration, I'm still required to rank it. Or, you know what I mean? Or I feel so strongly about this one, but I don't really care about any of the rest of them. The most I can do is give it a 1.
Yeah, and it gets weighted. I mean, it all gets weighted through the formula. So if everybody rates, let's, and student SLOs won't be on ours because we're the boys here. But I'll pick on the national board just because of where the numbers are. Let's say that ends up ranking 8th or 9th. Your aggregate score will be like a 1.2 or 1.5, something along those lines, which will mean that even if 5 or 6 people had it as a 10, being the most valuable, overall, it was ranked very low. So it didn't give you the option for a 0, but it still got weighted down to the bottom. Doesn't mean it won't be part of the system. Mm-hmm. Just means as far as how the staff as a whole views it, it's the case. If you're like the other districts who have taken this, and I can tell you because this is a pretty small sample size, additional skills, advanced degrees, length of service, PI 34, market incentives are probably going to drift toward the top. And the ranking of those might vary. In professional development, you could look to say, well, do we want to tie that in with something else or not? And we can talk about, are there too many categories or something? But the student learning outcomes, national board, have pretty consistently been at the bottom of the ranking. So I think we'll get to more of your point of, is this something we want to do anyway, by looking at it. And again, national board's kind of an oddity.
I do think the course ranking is valuable, because if you do the 4-point thing, you could have everybody rank every single item is very important, and that doesn't inform us of anything. So that would be one worry that I would have, because if we get to a point where we're trying to make decisions and prioritizing, the ranking is really important information to know.
If I'm forced to rank something that I don't care for at all, then I'm giving it a number value that's not truly what I feel. Is there a way I can say I do not want to rank this, I want to take this out of the category?
Or not applicable to me, kind of thing?
Yeah, can you rank 10 through 4 and then 0, 0, 0? Is that possible?
That helps.
We're not used to
it. Statistics. I think we're going to come up with the same outcome. People consistently put item F as, for the most people, put that as least important. When it does the weighting of these responses, it'll show up with a pretty major deviation. When I talked about how many of these come back similar on it, so if I look at this weighting, advanced degrees might get like a 6.76, which means it drifted toward, and then it will also break down by the number of people who responded as it being 1, 2, or 3. We'll see those percentages as well. So you can see on it, if, let's say, SLOs was in ours, which it won't be, if the answers were down here, that's pretty much a pretty clear indication that people really weren't gravitating toward that. So it mathematically, it shows up to us as if I gave it a 0, because it was my least valued out of those 10 particular elements. So if where we're at right now, is this a fair summarization that question 4 and 5, these are the open-ended text fields on strengths and weaknesses, we'll get to that ranking one again, would be placed after question 6. We place the open-ended more toward the end of the survey with the exception of question 9. My recommendation would be that you'd have one placeholder, so to speak, where they have to plug something in at the end so they just don't skip the last couple of questions. Does that make sense to everybody?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So then we get to, on the question 4 and 5, to Lori's piece, having an explanatory note, once again, about SLOs, no going backwards, and the principal evaluation, so then the universe of concerns might be somewhat restricted then. Does that make sense to everybody, to repeat that phraseology from the email? Not hearing any dissent, I assume that is dissent. Alan?
So are you saying we're taking that out?
No, we would take out the question. I'll call up the question.
I think you should take it out.
Which one's the weaknesses?
Oh, wait. What are you talking about?
We're in 4 and 5 right now.
Oh, strengths and weaknesses of the...
Oh, I thought you were talking about the ranking.
No.
Okay.
No. Strengths and
all right.
Strengths and weaknesses.
Glad I'm not the only one not paying
just
attention.
Yeah, this is just a little bit different location. Right, so we're still talking about the
of course
substance
we did.
Of this. If we do what Lori says, and I could just say there's 3 text boxes to fill it, and that's what you have. So you can go up to 3, you can have 1, you can fill in 0. We will get just a script of all these responses, then we can do the analysis as to which terms come up most frequently, and you can read the whole responses if you so choose. Either way, the data is available. So is there anything in the actual text of 4 and 5, the questions, that you wanted
change
to change?
It, well, of course there is.
Yeah.
How did we reword that, George?
Reworded.
As, going to
ready?
Yeah.
Bob?
Yes.
Okay. As you consider the district's approach to creating a compensation model, comma, rank. Oh no, that was number 4. We changed that one too. Rank. We did. Rank the importance of these factors for that system. So that is changing.
Oh yeah, you screwed him up now. That was question 6.
Yeah.
But okay.
Yeah,
but it's the new number 4.
Well, let's just go back to the original 4 on the.
So, what are the top 1 to 3 strengths of the last negotiated professional educator compensation system? I think we changed that.
Yeah, we changed professional educator compensation system to last negotiated compensation package. Right? Last negotiated compensation package.
Because that's what it was.
Well, that's what it is. It's
a
compensation package.
We're including benefits.
our assumption is that we are not just asking questions about salary, that we are talking about benefits as well.
Total compensation.
Yeah.
Just a contract.
Well, because we're not sure that people will get that's compensation package.
The contract doesn't usually generally refer to
contract has too much other more on it.
Yeah. I would think of like employee handbook stuff.
Total compensation plan or total compensation system
would
incorporate those, and you could even put in parentheses salary, benefits, VER.
You go, Tabitha.
I mean, it would give people the explanation of what it is.
Yeah, sure.
Because that way they could say, a strength of ours is we have a strong VER package. We do. That would be important for people to be able to talk about if that's important to them.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point.
What's VER?
Voluntary early retirement.
Salary benefits, post-employment benefits.
You're too young.
Post-employment.
About that.
I am too. I'm only
grand. Well, it's because it's your Wisconsin retirement system. It's your voluntary retirement.
Starts with the last negotiated compensation package.
Yeah, the stipend that you have, so it covers the number. Is that, and then we would just have the converse of that?
Yes. Yeah. See, look at how easy that would be.
Does that work? Is there anything else, anybody else, any other groups had any amendments to those?
Okay, I don't mean to be difficult, but is it really last negotiated, or is it the current compensation package?
Current.
Current. Yeah.
I don't like to, yeah, 2000.
Oh my God, we won't lose place with the work, right?
Yeah.
Similarly, the 1 to 3 weaknesses, and then we have the text box, the 3 text boxes underneath. Then, now to
George.
Not to let this table number 2 dominate. We'll
thank you.
Well, we don't. Well, breakout descriptions be visible for number 6. Where are we again here?
They're not all
the old number 6. Yeah.
So
when you go down to the next page, we just wanted to make sure that those descriptions on the left were actually what the teachers or the staff saw. That was awesome.
Okay.
We're going to eliminate the SLOs from this.
Right.
We did talk about
some of them. One thing that did come up in a different district, and I think this makes a lot of sense, it talks about advanced degrees, is that there's some explanatory note that the compensation system, let's say I got money for my master's degree, again, this would be a policy decision on behalf of the board. The board's not going to say, you were making $52,000 last year because you had a master's degree, now you're not going to make that anymore because you're not recognizing master's degrees. So just another point to clarify on the no steps back, meaning that if you had, you're making this amount and that's partially because of your master's degree, whether we have a separate additive for a master's degree or not, the committee hasn't decided, but your pay is not going to go back from the $52,000.
You say future advanced degrees? Does that clarify that?
That could do it.
Just so people don't.
Because that's how other districts who do this, they slotted people in with a master's degree. It wasn't like they got, I already have a master's, here's another $2,000, or you have the master's degree, we're not going to pay for your master's degree because you acquired it before. But other than that, what about these, we spent a little bit of time about the forced ranking. What about these items that are delineated, heard from table 4, Jay?
Is the educator's evaluation also going to be taken off?
Would we take
that out and modify it toward the plan of improvement or just eliminate it?
Our question was, is like educator evaluation, well that is, educator effectiveness. So yeah, our question was, would that be reworded to educator effectiveness, or would it be taken out completely because no principal evaluation is going to be
taken? I mean, it's a factor, right?
Then I guess my concern is, if you take that completely out, how do we get ever to how I teach in the classroom and deliver my curriculum, or is that ever on the scale?
It's an interesting question because it's kind of important to understand where the educators fall in terms of their thought on that, even though I think the board has been very clear that they're not going to use evaluation as a component of the compensation system.
So one of the things that was discussed, though, that may be useful is that there was a feeling that we were just getting started with educator effectiveness and that it would take at least a couple, 2 or 3 years to determine how's this working, how valid, how reliable are we in the ratings, and then at some point, is that really a viable thing to do? Maybe it is in a couple, 2 or 3 years, but to start out with a system that nobody knows about, people are nervous about, and that we don't even know if the measures are necessarily valid, we thought that that would be maybe not an effective place to start. Mm-hmm. So maybe one of the questions that you're raising, Dan, is should we put some things out there for future consideration, maybe given, let's say, success of educator effectiveness. So that was one thing that the board kind of spent time discussing, and I think that was kind of the intent, is to get that in the parking lot, potentially. Does that help a little bit?
It does, but I guess the thing that I'm getting at is everything else is outside the classroom.
Right.
Yeah, and I had the same feeling, too.
Now I'm having to go to workshops and maybe get courses that have nothing to do with my teaching in the classroom just to advance.
Yeah, I hope your compensation system doesn't do that. Our new ones haven't had that. They've been very connected, and they may have given you more options, you know, a broader menu. But your question on educator effectiveness is legitimate from the standpoint of, is it just going to be a hurdle you're going to clear? So you're not applying improvement. Don said you've got 3 or 4 total people in the district. So obviously 99% of the staff are clearing that hurdle, so there's not a differentiation. And at this point, the board said we're not going to dive into quote-unquote merit pay to say George is doing a better job than Bob in the classroom, so he gets more on that factor. It might be in the additional skills or duties, and that's what you probably saw in some of these other systems, that's another way that highly performing teachers rewarded through curriculum development being grade level share, maybe running a research project or something along those lines. So there's other avenues for that to be recognized.
Dan, is there a way to gauge that without saying educator effectiveness or principal evaluation?
That's what we did. Educator performance. How do we, about educator's performance in the classroom or something? Right, that's what I was not describing. It's not a number.
I'd be curious what the staff would say about my performance in the classroom.
That'd be high on me for me.
Yeah.
We may find a lot of teachers say, I want that to count. Mm-hmm. But we won't know if we don't ask.
I don't know where this question falls. It seems to fit. One of the questions I wrote down that I was talking to teachers about this, and I don't know where if it falls under base pay or if it falls under an alternative model or where it is, but one question I thought we might include, and I don't think it'll work with the survey, was what are teachers doing right now that they're not being compensated for? What are they doing well that they're not being compensated for? Because we all know teachers whose rooms are lit up by other teachers coming in and talking to them and asking them questions, and because they're good in the classroom or they work really well with special ed. And I just feel like, you know, you said last week that an organic system works best, a transplant doesn't work best. So can we look at what our teachers do well now and see if that's not being compensated? Is that a place to start? I don't know how it falls and how it matches with base pay versus compensation.
Yeah, before we drift off of the educator effectiveness, I just wonder, again, I'm going to put this in the eyes of the person taking the survey. If the email said you're not going to have a merit-based system, and then we have a question to rank educators' performance, I just view that if I was taking the survey, I'd find the two to be contradictory. So whatever term we come up with where we're using it, I don't think we want to contradict the big message. So they say, well, they said they weren't going to have merit pay, but then they asked if we wanted to have educators' performance.
Yeah, that was a point that I brought up before.
You know, how that gets balanced out in this versus there's some minimal expectation that you're hitting the district's.
And that's where we struggled here. We couldn't find the right words to allow it to not be some sort of an evaluation. but yet let me demonstrate I'm a good teacher in the classroom.
While the district is not currently evaluating or currently planning on using merit pay, are there something that you don't feel you're being paid for? I don't know, I'm trying to maybe put a preface in there, but even then when you say that, it makes people suspicious that you're planning on doing it another time.
It's better as an open-ended question.
Yeah. Well, we have that later on in like your hopes, and so I mean, someone could put in there, I would like my performance to be taken into account or something, if that's something they want. And I've had plenty of teachers in these committees when we've done it other places say that, and you get this, okay, well, if the board doesn't want to do SLOs, we don't want to do educator effectiveness, what is the measuring mechanism we're using to determine your performance other than you're meeting our expectations? And so if we have tiers or levels, you've moved because you're satisfied.
Jay, to answer, oh, I'm sorry, you have your hand up.
Well, I just want to kind of piggyback on what Jay had alluded to, and I think that there's some interesting models out there that take into account teacher leaders who other people gravitate towards for just what he was talking about. So I don't know that the survey is the right place for that discussion, but I think that, you know, within the discussion of what we're looking at.
It could come up in Q7.
It could, yeah.
It's be an opportunity that you believe could be built in that isn't currently built in.
Right.
So that's where people could say, you know, teacher leadership or, you know, leadership within
the curriculum that I'm sharing with other teachers and that people
valued or recognized in some way.
Right.
I'm wondering if at a future agenda item that we could literally set aside some time to do some of the conversation about this topic to sort of take it apart a little bit, because I think there's a lot going on here that would really be worth this group, which, like it or not, this is going to be kind of the expert group in the district, and we could take a look at if we believe that there should be compensation related to your ability to teach and to be effective in the classroom, what would that look like, if that's true? We do that internally, I'm saying, not as a survey, but here. What would that look like, and how would we approach that as just a topic to discuss here? If we looked at it for like a half an hour to just try to take it apart, because I think people are interested in it, but the sort of the problem is the details and how that would work and what the effects of different ways to do that would be. And I think the concern, one of the bigger concerns, not the only concern, we had somewhat of a competitive system that the top 20% of the teachers get paid more because they're better. Would that create a competitive environment versus a collaborative one? And would that be good for the district and for teaching overall? That's just one element, but I think it might be worth a conversation as part of our agenda, and maybe that's something we want to spend more time on, but it would allow us to sort of figure that one out as a committee. That's maybe a proposal that would help us with this topic.
What we could do is, if we wanted to eliminate educators' evaluation and SLOs from the document, we have additional skills here. We could put in just present skills plus additional skills. Maybe that's a broad one category. And then we can have the conversation you're talking about now.
Sure.
Cooperating teachers.
Right, because leadership falls under an additional skill in many ways. I mean, people may think of it that way.
Yeah, I mean, I could put some examples of the building chair, leadership, curriculum chair, et cetera,
how would you prove that to the district?
The additional certifications, et cetera. We could flesh that out.
Part of the frustration with this for me is it's just the same frustration I have with the high-stakes tests our kids have. These are all things that you can verify with, you know, a degree or a course or whatever, or I was appointed chair. But, you know, a really good classroom teacher that's collaborating and thinking outside the box and bringing their peers in and working on things, that's a very difficult way. Those are all great things that I think we want our kids to have, but we also want our teachers to model. And how do we grab that and say, we value this and we want people like that, and have it be a fair system so that, you know, teachers aren't afraid, well, my principal doesn't really like me, so they're not going to give me credit for that. But that's the kind of thing I'd like to see implemented in our own very own, because that's what we keep saying to the teachers. We want you to be this way. We want you to be creative. We want you to and yet we don't recognize it.
Right, and that could be in the professional development criterion, it could be in coaching, it could be in mentoring. There's a lot of different avenues that you can take it. It's just hard to encapsulate this.
Right. No, I think it's a future thing. It's not, we can't do it now. I don't
but with respect to this question, are we in agreement that we can tweak this additional skills to put some leadership qualities in there or collaborative qualities? Because someone may have gotten training on facilitating. I could add that into the additional skills component. And then
I think that's it. Yeah. This is the place.
SLOs. Is there any opposition to jettisoning the SLOs?
No, there isn't.
So that's gone. So now we're the educator effectiveness.
I just had one more. Not educator effectiveness, if you want to finish that.
That effectiveness, what are your thoughts? Table one, should it stay or should it go?
Use it, so why
shouldn't
we have it in there?
Yeah, I think it's gone. Yeah. We're telling in the letter that we're not using it.
You can go.
It's the unintended message.
Yeah.
Important, but it's not going to be used for pay.
Not on this. Yeah,
we're not going to later.
We're just, yeah. It's very important. Then we'd have to be
giving
a handle.
And I'm done for a while. I have one survey right now. We're just trying to get a temperature.
I mean, if that's something that has to be involved, they can mention
no doubt.
It there.
But
I wonder if that's
a question. How much do we
find? Well, I have an idea item, something.
What the difference in the buildings would be.
Could be inserted, possibly, of our teachers who've won local, state, national awards. We have several award-winning teachers in the district. I don't know if this part of the survey is the right place for that, but
top-notch teacher.
Well, we put it under like national boards.
I could underneath the national board.
National boards national and board. Other awards and recognition.
That might be good.
Be, yeah, state and national. Cool awards.
Right. Not that he's going to get. It will make that group that bigger? Has had that a lot bigger. So it's not just like five or six of you answering that.
Yeah, well, that's what I was thinking. Does
crystal
the crystal apple count?
Yeah, I was going to say.
Because I'm going to.
Interesting that we have two teachers.
I'm going to nominate myself.
That's well, remember, this is just the group saying what they think.
I got a group
of
kids that I could.
This is something to tag.
I'm going to nominate you. I'm nominate me.
Well, could be you know, yeah. Did you say you have a top-notch teacher with me?
Did we want to bring up the cameras?
Anything else on that question before we get into the seminar?
I knew she was.
I was under the line. I would have to get this. Unfortunately, we can get this
we've
now.
We've been together too long.
Yes.
All right, are we on question seven?
Yes.
Okay, we thought it was a little wordy because we want to get ahead of table two because they're going to put more words in.
Oh, no!
Here's where we are with question seven. The first one says, what are you hopeful for? Question mark. Then it says, what are 1 to 3 opportunities that could improve upon our last professional educator compensation system, period? What are 1 to 3 opportunities that could improve upon our last professional educator compensation system? We just thought, oh boy, I got to have to read that twice at 7:30 at night when I'm doing this survey. We just thought about maybe.
What was your simplified version?
Okay. What are 1 to 3 opportunities? Do you want me to start the first question or the second part of the question? The first part was, what are you hopeful for? Question mark. Which goes before. Yep.
We're jettisoning that.
Yeah, we did that.
We got rid of that.
There's one of these specific
about the
compensation.
Well, I'm getting to that. And then, just hopeful for question mark. And then after that, what are 1 to 3 opportunities that could improve upon our last professional educator compensation system? We couldn't think of a way to shorten that. Just maybe compensation system?
Oh, my wife wouldn't let me have one of those anymore.
What
is what we did before?
What are 1 to 3 opportunities that could improve upon our last
current compensation
system? Bam. And then we did the same thing to question 8. Was with what worries you? Question mark. And then what are the top 1 to 3 challenges that? Blah blah blah.
And we did.
Or something to that effect. We just thought it was
real much.
We didn't have any other specific recommendations. I personally, I think that sounds good, but.
We had just what are one to, we just took out kind of that whole last and said what are what are one to three. It was like, we just changed it to like, what are you, what are one to three things you're hopeful for in a new compensation system?
That would do it.
Yeah, what are the top one to three challenges in our current compensation?
What are you worried about?
Keep it
simple. One to three things you're worried about from a new compensation.
See, we just jettisoned a bunch of it.
What she said.
Yeah, we agree.
Or what are one to three things you're worried about?
Yeah.
Instead of the word challenges, right?
Yeah, so we just, instead of referring back to the current, we just. So what are one to three
things you are hopeful for with a new
compensation? From a new compensation.
For a new compensation.
Yeah, with or for a new comp, whatever the article.
English
thing is
correct.
There, yeah.
There's too many.
In a new compensation
system.
No, no, no. This would be what, half an hour? Because
we get about 6 minutes.
So. And what are the three items that you are concerned about?
Yeah, what are one to three things you're losing sleep over?
The different clocks.
I guess. Cool.
With the.
You could just say that concern you about a new compensation package.
Mm-hmm. Making it active. Very nice.
She is. You picked it up.
It's a chocolate smack.
Complimenting you on your grammatical ability.
I said, you think?
Concern you about.
Whoa.
Oops.
Yes, what's the
answer? Right, then, I mean, obviously, before we send it out.
It's a breezy day. Everybody's doing it. Not sure.
I want to know who's going to do the
everybody, what we're trying to glean from them. Mm-hmm. Again, this will
yes, be that's much better.
And we get to our number nine here. And this one, I think, take how much was talked about earlier, we would move to be the very last question. So we have the placeholders for the test. Are there any things that, any particular items within this that people wanted added, subtracted, amended?
Mm-hmm. We talked about adding a I don't know.
Yeah. Instead of no opinion.
Yeah, we did too.
Yeah. Because one of them says the practices in my district are, I don't know, I can't read it.
So what
fair
is
or fair or like the practices in my district.
Consistent for all
consistent. And my response to that would be,
I
it's not that I have an opinion about it. I have an opinion about it. I don't know. And so, I think that's important for people to say, I don't know.
Important piece of information to gather. Do we need to educate people on certain things?
We also talked about in the very first item separating, I am satisfied with the pay and benefits into two items.
Remember the pay after? Yeah.
Those are two very different things.
Yeah.
Good. No, I've spoken up.
Go for it. You're doing great.
Oh, and then drop the last two items.
Last two items.
Yeah, because we feel like the last two items, we're not asking about whether people understand their benefits right now. We're asking them how they want to be compensated.
So those would be.
Or whether they get support or not has not much to do with that whole.
Right. I don't understand why those were even on there.
I disagree. We just asked them two of the questions. We mentioned the total compensation package with benefits and everything. So if we're not talking about it, why do we just change all the language?
Well, there's questions about benefits up there, but whether or not they get help with problems with their benefits, how does that relate to how they rank that value?
Yeah, that's an HR.
I feel like they don't exactly what
I mean. It's a good question, just like, not for this survey.
I asked that when I do the survey for employee services feedback. I asked that question in that survey.
How about is Tabitha nice?
Right. Well, again, people will have their opinion about that, but I'm not sure that
can we say
finding leave time?
They still have the benefits pieces in there, but whether or not they get help with their problems with benefits, I'm not sure that that's informative for this process.
I don't know that's relevant to what we're trying to do.
Exactly.
Are you going to allow comments for some of these that are just where they're ranked? Because sometimes if somebody says, you know, I disagree with that pay practices are administered equally, and if it's possible for people to write.
I can easily add a text,
is that something
text
other people
field
think
to
would be?
Elaborate mm-hmm. on your above questions. It's easy enough to put in.
If that's something that other people think would be helpful.
Information is always helpful.
Comments. Bob, our group suggested that the where it says the leave time provided, just to put in parentheses, reimbursable, comma, personal, so that they know which
types of leave
we're referring to.
I had to get them today and what I didn't get them.
I'm always like that.
Right, because that's federal law.
No, it's called personal.
Yeah.
But when you put it into.
Well, I don't know. You can put FMLA
put
in there, but.
FMLA? You have, those are the two you
law.
Use.
Yeah.
No.
Not unless you have time. Unless you substitute.
Why is there paid maternity leave?
There isn't.
Short term disability.
I had a company.
I was.
So just to get back on the survey, any other questions that groups, any of the respective groups came up with that we haven't already covered, and say, you know what, I did see this question, I'd like to have that asked.
Exactly.
So start over, is your group over here?
We're good.
You're good?
Yep.
We're good.
Jay, your group?
Nope, we're okay.
George,
you're good?
Mm-hmm. Ellen?
When she said inserting a text box, I asked her, did she mean underneath each one that you ranked, or just that specific question? And she suggested it was for each one, so I don't know.
Oh my gosh, I think people will
just one.
I think the more text box you have, the more likely people are to just not fill in any of the text boxes.
So just one at the end, saying, yeah. Please elaborate on any concerns or questions you have.
Or further
any
comments?
Additional comments.
Yeah.
Further comments.
Yeah.
Just additional comments.
That work?
Yeah, I think that would be
right.
Anything
so
we didn't touch.
The
27th.
From 8 to 3.
2 weeks from today.
All day one.
We can get this thing out.
You can get it out by Friday.
Yeah, are you taking us to Ruth for a second?
Absolutely.
Get your credit card ready.
I get it.
Absolutely.
Yes, Carrie, I'll be your friend.
I'm selective.
It's very simple to leave it open until you ask. There's no question on it. This is very automatic process of the data. So we're meeting on the 26th. We're going to be closing down that Saturday or something.
For our next meeting.
Thank you.
27th is a Tuesday.
So yeah, give them a weekend.
Yeah. Monday morning. Write it down and then we can run the
variance. It'll be forgotten.
You're also going into exams next week at the high school
teacher. And we're in assessment. We're in the assessment window at elementary. So that's a little
closer.
So
we want
March
3rd or
4th?
Yes. The sooner the better.
Rob, the sooner the better.
March 4th is now March 3rd.
I also not a Friday.
Like to me.
Okay.
Okay.
Every time I send an email on a Friday, I never hear back from a teacher. Then I remind them on Monday.
Third Street has the open house.
Are we good on the 3rd?
Or the 4th?
Third instead of the fourth.
Third instead of the fourth. One last thing. By the time we get the survey ready, I'll figure out because they didn't want it to go out on a Friday. So if we don't get it cranked up ready to go on Thursday, do we want to wait till Monday? It still gives everybody a week to do it.
Monday, we
I think we can send it out by Thursday.
We should, right, we should be, but I have to see if I can have the person do this stuff.
Okay.
So.
I prefer Monday over Friday. Friday, I'm shutting down.
If we get to the point where it's going to be sent out on Friday, can we send it on Monday morning?
That's instead? What you're just saying.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Except we don't have school Monday.
Oh, touche.
So we want to get it up.
I think we really want to push for by the end of the day Thursday.
Yeah, that's. I mean, I prefer Thursday, but Friday I'm like email no. Huh? You know, by like 1 o'clock on Friday, you're like,
I'll answer. Maybe I'll just come over.
I don't want to answer anymore this week. And
I mean,
anything else we have?
I do. I admit it. No, I just assumed you. Like, tavern on Friday night at 10. Hold on, I'm taking survey.